not getting here. There's always a little bit left in the very bottom. Knock yourself out. Okay, tapped out. Told you.
I'm hungry.
We're all hungry, Sweetie.
If we don't find something to eat soon, we'll have to move rocks.
No.
Well, then it's staying here and starve.
This is the best you can get around town.
3%. Except 3 for the bear could be around someplace. I don't want to leave it here, but I got one. Ah. All right.
Well, all right, Begley. I believe you might have a winner this time, if you can stay away from those poker tables. And I'll loan you this $100, and I'll be praying for your success in Juno with those lip-smacking bones.
And I hope this camp is used by children for many years to come. starts today, but by tomorrow, it is rehashed, reviewed, retouched, rewritten, and then regurgitated. Some history is about a place. Some history about a people. And then there is some history that is all about me. President's Day weekend, 1991. It was my first winter in Alaska. I moved from Chicago just 6 months before. Things were starting to come together for me. I just found a place to live at 3rd and Gold in downtown Juneau. Before that, I'd been camping, house sitting, and couch surfing. Now, it was just a small place in an old house that probably was a grand single family back in the day, but had long ago been divided up for those heading up and those heading down. Now, I've been going through some small town culture shock. I mean, I moved from a place where if you end a relationship, all you have to do is hang up the phone to a place where you cannot avoid an ex. So I was involved in a discreet relationship with a woman I met the old-fashioned way, in a bar. Sunday morning, 3 a.m., the phone rings. I'm over at her place after a night out. The next thing I know, she's shaking me. Wake up! It's the police! They're looking for you!
What?
Yeah, no, they just want to know if you're okay.
What?
Your house, it's on fire. What? I was stunned. Not only was my home burning, but the police knew where to find me. There are no secrets in a small town. By the time I got over there, the place was engulfed in flames. The guy that lived below me had gone to sleep with a candle burning. That evening, I lost almost everything I owned. Now granted, it wasn't much. I moved here in a Toyota Corolla, but what I owned was important to me. Books that my grandfather had given me, photos, and an excellent collection of outdoor gear. To say that people helped me out is just a total understatement. People came out of the woodwork, offered me places to live, gave me cash, a tent, a camera, and lots of t-shirts. I thought my clothes had survived. After all, the closet was the furthest from the flames, but the heat had weakened them. Some I would take and put in the laundry, and they looked good going in, but coming out, they looked like rags. One time I put on a dress shirt, and the entire sleeve came off. Now, one of the other things that was coming together for me at this time was that I had gotten a job at the Department of Transportation. And I knew that on the Tuesday after that holiday, the fire would be big news at work. Now, I was dealing with all kinds of stuff, you can imagine. But not the least of which was, by Tuesday, my only pair of underwear was beyond the pale. I lost the rest of them when the cardboard box I stored them in went up in flames. And so, underneath my 100% cotton dockers, I was going commando. Now, I'm a guy that likes to get in early before the madness of the day, and our section's administrative assistant, she was an early bird too, and she was at my desk soon after arriving. Rosella was a good Christian woman who wore modest prairie dresses and couldn't have stood more than 4'8". I heard her coming down the hallway, and so I swiveled in my chair and struck a nonchalant pose. And unbeknownst to me, the seam in the crotch of those 100% cotton dockers had split all four directions, giving that good Christian woman a very clear view. Rosella's eyes got wide and her mouth dropped open. And it took me just a beat too long to figure out what was going on. And then it felt like my legs came together in slow motion. What happened next, I consider a quintessential Alaskan moment. Rosella was a cabin dweller. She lived in the woods off the grid. And she had commandeered an unused cubicle and filled it with all the electrical gadgets that she couldn't use at home. She often spent break time prepping dinner with her Cuisinart. And in that cubicle was a sewing machine. She recovered before I did. Tell you what we're going to do. We're going to go down to the men's room. You're going to take off your pants. You're going to hand them out to me. I'm going to go sew them up and bring them back. So a tiny woman in a prairie dress, who I'd known only weeks, sewed my pants and salvaged my dignity. And as I stood in that bathroom, naked from the waist down, I thought, who are these crazy people who live in this rainy place? But I tell you what, I am so glad that I lost it all in a place like Southeast Alaska. Thank you.
$2 an acre. What a deal!
How come?
guys.
Me neither. You can't convince me that that was the sun and the moon in that camera.
Mr. Stewart seems to be a brave and honorable man, though a little pighead. But what he says is happening is impossible, and yet it is getting darker. Mr. Stewart, if you are causing this, it must stop.
I assure you, I'm not.
What?
Feel that wind?
George, Owen, Gordon.
Oh, yes, and Emma, and Josephine, and Harriet. So nice that you all could come. You know, this is really a momentous occasion. I want you all to know that I have pushed for 3 years to get a up-to-date ambulance that would serve the needs of this growing citizenry. You can applaud. And I believe that this is a day that Haines can say that we've grown a little. And it is a proud moment. And we have a little program.
Charlotte.
Thank you, Mayor.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, girls. Give me an A!
A!
Give me an M!
A!
Give me a B!
B!
Give me an A!
A!
Jackson Long, the rug that I wove, Carol Tyneman, John Svensson's print, Crystal, Rep Weave Table Runner, and that's from Brigitte Buck and Liz, Carol Clifton's card prints, Shannon Willard, Chilkat Guide's rafting trip, Annette Smith, Donna Cattotti's original pastel, Walt, Alaska Seaplanes Flight Number 1, Suzanne Smith. Alaska Seaplanes Flight 2 is Lou Lowry. The pinch pot from Carrie Cohen is Lori. The white birch print from Joni Wagner is Lucia Nascimento. Lunch at the Bamboo Room, Lee Harris. The king salmon felted fish from Joe Parnell is Michael. Mandy Ramsey's photo on canvas, Selby. The dragonfly earrings from Debbie Nightkendi, me. Wine sauces by Sauce Sauces, Deborah Schnabel. The hand-thrown bowl from Betsy Bamberg is Stephen. I hope it's Stephen. I really had a hard time with that. Sorry. And the hand-woven scarf from Joe McCammett is Nick Berkey, I think. Okay, that's it. Two of us at the table as you're leaving in a little while, if you could stop by and pay as many, you know, collect your items. Thanks.
Okay, the adjudicators have been in the back and they've been talking to each other, and we're going to bring them out here shortly. So hang tough and we'll get our short adjudication of the performances. And by the way, this was just the first effort of the first round of skits. And if anybody here is inspired to maybe write their own skit, or you have a piece of history that you were thinking to yourself, maybe, you know, the history that I'm thinking of or my favorite story should be made into a skit as well, then the door is wide open. This just hopefully opens the door and inspires a few people, and maybe we'll get to see your skits. We'd love to see that. So let me go check in the back and see how our adjudicators are. Oh, Tom? Yeah, come on up, Heather. There you are. All right, let's hear it for the adjudicators.
Thank you, Dan. Well, as you know, it was very difficult judging these acts. They were all so very good. So we'd like to start with some special awards. The Best Introduction and Best Ted Gregg Award goes to Dan Henry. You know, hold some of your applause. Best Impersonation of a Young Dan Henry goes to Charlie Henry. Best Ghost Senior Citizen Love Scene goes to Ben Bard and Margaret Stevens. Best Strawberry to the Big Strawberry. That was great, whoever the strawberry was. Best Portrayal of a Church, the Presbyterian Church. We really love the Presbyterian Church. And the Best Spell, Selby Long. And then the Best Brother of a Person that gave the spell, Jackson Long. Jackson,
Tom,
stand up.
Tom, you're taking this campaigning way too far.
What do you mean?
I liked it better when you were the editor of the Chilkat Valley News and you didn't like anything.
I hopped everything.
Did you sell one of the cars?
Everything.
Huh, we're supposed to give out.
Okay, well now we will find the good.
Three awards, Tom. The most hysterical skit.
Most hysterical goes to Sirens with Charlie Henry. Best historical.
Dead or alive.
Oh, dead or alive.
Wait, that's really true. I sat next to CJ and she told me that was the most historical one. And Tom wanted to rule it out because of the cell phone, but.
Subtract a little bit.
That was just his old self.
That's the old Tom
Woodward. His old self decided it was a wonderful skit.
And histrionic. Oh, there you go.
Yes, Charlie, you get, what is it? Dead or alive?
Dead or alive. So this is the ghost love scene award. Okay. So the best histrionic, and we thought almost MVP, Blue.
Histrionic. Absolutely.
vote for the other guy.
Thank you.
Thank you.